So, you know, looking around at some of the faces here, I'm thinking that some of you are still just too young to be at an event about old age. Then again, you know, Michael Kinsley, who turned 65 last month, is arguably too young to have written a book that he's calling a beginner's guide to old age. Now, Mike, of course, has been nothing if not precocious for a good part of his career. I think he says so somewhere early in the book. So I suppose he's being true to form in getting an early start in writing about old age. He does have a pretty good excuse, in as much as he was only 43 when he was diagnosed with Parkinson's disease. So mortality became less of an abstraction earlier for him than perhaps for other members of the boomer generation. And the physical and philosophical aspects of aging have loomed larger for him. But Mike also always has been a pretty ambitious guy. And he readily admits at wanting to write about old age before other authors and journalists of his generation get around to it. This book is a thin, small work, which is very considerate, actually, of those who perhaps don't have much time left to read. But it's also very considerate of many other customers who would just like a quick read about a pretty somber subject. But it's also, as you would expect of Mike, a very amusing and insightful book. Many of us have been reading Mike's journalism or listening to his commentaries for, it seems, forever. Since graduating from Harvard, studying at Oxford on a Rhodes, and earning a Harvard Law degree, Mike, I think, has written or edited for just about every prominent publication in existence. But most notably, he's edited The New Republic, Harper's, and The Washington Monthly, served as American editor of The Economist, founded Slate, and now is a Vanity Fair columnist. And I skipped over stints at the Los Angeles Times and Time and contributions to The New Yorker and maybe some others. And of course, years ago, he gained TV fame as a moderator on Firing Line and co-host of Crossfire. The reviews of Mike's book so far have been full of praise about its wit and well-pitched prose. And Huffington Post has the book on its list of top five hot books, which is not bad for a geezer, huh? Anyway, Mike will be.
How old is Ariana?
Mike will be in conversation here this evening with Timothy Noah, who's still in his late 50s. Tim also has had a distinguished career as a journalist, working for some of the same publications as Mike, including The New Republic, The Washington Monthly, and Slate, as well as U.S. News and World Report, The Wall Street Journal, and Newsweek. He's now labor policy editor for Politico, and several years ago he came out with really a great book on inequality titled The Great Divergence. So, ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Michael Kinsley and Tim Noah.
Well, Mike, I'm going to start out on a very literal level. Your book is called Old Age. I'm reading these questions off a piece of paper because even though I'm only 58, I am AARP eligible. Your book is called Old Age. And recently, you, as Brad noted, you turned 65. This was too late to get into your book. But we used to think that 65 was old. Do you have any particular thoughts about reaching that milestone?
Well, it was predictable, wasn't it? I can't pretend to be surprised.
Do you have any David Brooks-like expansive thoughts about the meaning of life at 65?
No, I don't think I'm any wiser than I was a few days ago when I was 64.
Have you started collecting Social Security? And
you know, all I've done is go to the web and type in turning 65 just to see what you're supposed to do.
Mm-hmm.
And it's unbelievably complicated. You know, I think, you know, I get into this in the book. I think I'm a reasonably intelligent person, and I can't figure out how to go about, you know, registering for Medicare and Social Security and all the other benefits that you pay for. I would say that I'm developing the self-righteousness that you need to have to go with collecting government benefits.
You suddenly look down on other people who are collecting government benefits that aren't 65 or older.
Yeah.
On a more serious note, you talk in your book about a different age, which is 63, which you say is the age at which one friend of yours can be counted on to die every year. Do you have any thoughts about reaching that milestone?
Well, it was, you can't really say counted on to but it, and the calculation would not pass muster with very, very many real mathematicians. I mean, I just sort of assume that everybody has 100 friends,
mm-hmm.
and things like that. So I wouldn't want to defend that 63. But it is, in the book, the way I explain my calculation, and you can see how ridiculous it is, the calculation is in the course of explaining it. I think I explain a lot of other things too.
Mm-hmm. The book is a kind of a sneak preview for baby boomers of what it's like to get old based on your experience with Parkinson's. And initially, you're right, you had three choices, acceptance, confrontation, or denial. And you went with denial. And you write that denial is frowned upon in our culture and that it shouldn't be. Can you talk to us about that?
Well, yes. When something like this happens, you can you have really only two choices, because confrontation and denial, because acceptance is an aspiration, really, not a practical solution. Denial is frowned upon in our society. You're supposed to confront your whatever it is, trying to think. See, this is something you have to confront. It's called the tip of the tongue syndrome.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, something's right. It's the same thing as the senior moment,
mm-hmm.
except that the doctors have gotten a hold of it and medicalized it. Denial is, well, you can go through the day and not be thinking about it.
Right.
So that seems to me to be quite advantageous.
Oh, absolutely.
Confrontation goes along with community as another value. So you're supposed to, and really, I think it's a personal choice. Michael J. Fox, you know, has devoted his life to trying to find a cure for Parkinson's disease ever since he was diagnosed. And I haven't done a damn thing. You know, so I think you've got to hand it to him, but at the same time, it's not for, that approach is not for me.
Well, there's a critique of the confrontation approach too. Our mutual friend Barbara Ehrenreich, when she had breast cancer, found herself absolutely despising the people who kept telling her, "You have to fight this," because she sort of felt like it really wasn't going to be up to her very much what the outcome was going to be, and she hated having that responsibility placed on her shoulders. There's a way of sort of personalizing it that that she found distasteful. Like, if I get better, is it something I did? If I don't get better, is that my fault? Have you sort of thought about
the? Oh, I've forgotten my point. There you go.
Have people said extremely irritating things to you in this vein of,
oh,
you've lived an unhealthy life, you brought this on yourself? New Agers love to say stuff like this.
Well, no, the irritating things have actually been mostly from people who are well-meaning.
Uh-huh.
The nicer sort of people tend to do the things that irritate you more. Well, there was, at a dinner party, a woman offered to cut my meat for me.
Right.
Even though she had just seen me eating the first course, I don't remember what it was, with no problem. And, you know, she was definitely well-meaning, but I could live without it.
Right. you write, one episode you write about in the book is about being offered the editorship of The New Yorker and then having that offer withdrawn after you told the owner of The New Yorker that you had Parkinson's. As a reader, I felt, as I was reading that part of your book, that I saw a pretty clear relationship between cause and effect. But you write in the book that it was probably more complicated than that. Can you elaborate?
Well, Cy Newhouse, the owner of The New Yorker,
who is now himself quite old.
Yes, that's it. Well, you know, there are only two options. To me, it's Cy has made the right choice. basically, you have the story right. I'm not getting into that anymore. Okay. I feel that they've actually, Cy and the editor, the guy who got the job, David Remnick, have been gentlemen about it, and they've never tried to deny it. And David has been a very good editor of The New Yorker, and I had a lot of fun creating Slate, and I met my wife as a result. So it's been a win-win-win-win situation.
And for me, too, I should point out, because you say that if you were later told that if you had gone to The New Yorker, Microsoft probably would have shut Slate down.
Well, I have a very good source for that.
And I went to work for Slate a year or two afterwards, so that wouldn't have worked out so well for me. So it seems like everybody won all around. Let's talk. Can you talk about some of the other unpleasant ways that people have treated you differently? This is a theme. I remember Paul Glastris writing about this years ago in a wonderful piece he wrote for the Washington Monthly. Paul has limited use of his arms, and he wrote a piece, very eye-opening piece, about how much it drove him crazy, and people were always sort of leaping to help him with things before he asked. And Jonathan Rowe, our friend Jonathan Rowe, who passed away a few years ago, wrote a sidebar talking about having a stutter, saying it drove him crazy when people finished his sentences for him, which immediately prompted me to think, well, he and I had worked at the Washington Monthly together side by side. And I thought, I know I must have finished his sentences about 1,000 times.
Well, Charlie Peters, the editor of The Washington Monthly, probably finished his sentences just to make sure he got them right, according to Charlie.
Are there other ways that people try to be helpful where they're not helpful at all?
Well, I haven't reached, I don't think, the point where I need a lot of, where I evidently need a lot of help. And so it's not, I haven't faced that. I'm sure it's extremely irritating, but I haven't faced it much yet.
Mm-hmm. It's funny. I have a memory when I first came to work at the New Republic. My first day at the New Republic was also the first day for Charles Krauthammer. And I actually have a very distinctive memory of your coming up to me and saying, I don't know if Charles knows how to get out of the office. Can you just sort of keep an eye on him? And he did, it turned out. But we did it exactly the right way. We were very discreet. We just sort of looked from a distance, and he was fine.
He was amazing. He showed up. We had put an ad in the magazine saying, do you want to be managing editor of the New Republic? And we got a response from about 200 lawyers and this one guy who was a psychiatrist. And the day that we were supposed to come by the office, you know, he came in on his very elaborate wheelchair and was perfectly okay. And you don't know how to treat people in those circumstances. So that's why that's really why I wouldn't complain.
Have you and Charles ever talked about this syndrome?
Well, Charles was the first person I called after I got the word from the doctor.
Mm-hmm.
And he put me in touch with another doctor in Boston. So that was,
Did he have larger sort of life advice for you on how to deal with this?
Well, he's in a much worse situation than me, and I wouldn't bring it up.
Mm-hmm.
for fear of hurting his feelings or doing it exactly the way you describe it.
You're not referring to his being a regular Fox contributor, I assume.
No, that's incurable.
Well, let's talk a little bit about baby boomers. This book can be read as a kind of elegy for the largest generation in American history, although I should put an asterisk on that. Somebody recently told me that so many baby boomers have died off now that there are more millennials than baby boomers out there. But even millennials have to be blamed on the baby boom, right? Because they're the children of the baby boom.
Well, there's waves.
They're the sort of echo effect. They used to be called the echo effect. Yeah. Anyway, your book is an elegy for the baby boom. And throughout your career, you have been a rare defender of baby boomers. And I remember you wrote a piece about yuppies, defending even yuppies. And this is a generation that you feel has gotten a bum rap. Can you tell us a little bit about that?
You know, I saw that in the notes which you slipped me. And I'm not sure I know what you're referring to. I wrote a piece about it's okay to have a coffee grinder if you want one.
Right.
But
you also felt that Vietnam protesters were vilified unjustly to some extent, that it really was an immoral war and so on.
Oh, yeah. The veterans movement, I guess you'd have to call it, and other things, now you're not allowed to say it's sort of assumed that the Vietnam War was a terrible mistake, but you know, how do you accommodate the thank you for your service?
Mm-hmm.
I think that it's great that veterans are getting their due. I think that it was always a terrible exaggeration that when people said that veterans had not had our friend Jack Schaefer is an expert on the subject of people spitting at veterans.
Right.
And he says it basically never happened.
Right.
So you want to be generous and thankful to veterans. At the same time, you want people to understand the truth about the Vietnam War. And that's a very tricky thing to do both of those things.
But your feeling is this wasn't just a bunch of people trying to save their hides. They had serious moral considerations.
I mean, I guess you're a little
I decided I needed to complete junior high school. I'd rather do that than. So, yes, no, I was too young.
Yeah. Well, I was just, I was sort of the last year of everything.
Your book takes an unexpected turn towards the end, and it becomes a kind of policy tome. You propose that boomers' gift to the next generation should be to balance the government's books. And that put some reviewers off. They thought that was too conservative a goal. But one method you propose to achieve that end is to jack up the inheritance tax, which it seemed to me has a nice leftist Pikettian ring to it. This is, I know, something that you've been writing about for decades, the strange logic behind lowering inheritance taxes. You've always thought it was absurd that inheritance taxes should be either sort of very low or very easy to avoid. I remember you wrote a great piece for the New Republic about this back in the 80s. Can you sort of talk a little bit about what your thoughts are about the inheritance tax compared to other types of taxes, and answer the political question: why has it gotten so hard to tax dead people?
Well, supposedly George McGovern in 1972 had made an issue of inheritance taxes. He thought they should be higher, and the conventional wisdom is that was a mistake, because everybody, even if they're not going to pay the tax, hope that they will, or that their children will, and therefore you can't propose an inheritance tax. Of course, we know that you can't propose any kind of tax in this country. And it's very odd, Tim, nothing wrong with it, but you say you associate, you said conservatives.
Oh, conservatives didn't like your emphasis on balancing. I mean, liberals didn't like your emphasis on balancing the budget.
Yeah, well, you can balance the budget at a high level.
Right.
Or you can balance the budget at a low level.
Right.
It doesn't really have anything to do with it. I'm in favor of balancing the budget at a very high level. And the politics of it have been bizarre. In Ronald Reagan, naturally, was for lowering the deficit. Mm-hmm. He didn't do anything about it, but he talked about it. It was certainly a major theme. And then when Democrats got into power, they changed, all the Republicans changed their minds.
Right.
And what Reaganomics is what they called it when they were in power. And part of Reaganomics was the deficits didn't matter.
Right.
And then Democrats get in, and all of a sudden Dick Cheney is saying deficits don't matter.
Right, and then the Democrats actually did balance the budget, and conservatives became very upset that meant that the government was now sort of taking all this money from you that it was actually going to spend directly on government programs, and we couldn't we had to do something about that. We had to shrink the size of government because the budget was in balance. I never could quite follow what that was about.
They came up with this term, astonishing term, Rubenomics. In other words, all our problems are the fault of Bob Rubin, who was Secretary of the Treasury under
Clinton. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and you know, well, it was ridiculous.
The logic, as I recall, was that if you had a balanced budget, then suddenly liberals would be able to start new programs because they didn't have the weight of the deficit.
Not a completely absurd line of reasoning.
No, That's yeah. true.
But the idea that Bob Rubin is responsible for our problems, and that he's it's a bad thing.
Mm-hmm. And now I'm. You think that we should that liberals and Democrats still should value a government that's solvent, and you can reach solvency by raising taxes just as easily as by cutting government programs, and that raising taxes might be preferable if you want to maintain a high level of government spending.
That's very good.
So you don't worry about, you know, there are these people who worry that if government becomes too large a percentage of GDP, that the skies will fall.
That I don't worry about that, and I also don't, well, I don't worry too much about what liberals worry about, which is
that liberals worry that if you get too concerned about balancing the budget, then, well, after the recession, they worried that you wouldn't spend enough to stimulate the economy.
Right.
And I think now they worry that there are other needs that won't get addressed because the conservatives were right. They really do want to expand the government.
Well, but Reagan said it. You know that we're like a family,
mm-hmm.
and we can't live beyond our means. To say he did nothing about it, that he made it much worse. But isn't that true at some level? I mean, that's what I'd like to, you know, get Paul Krugman and shake him and say, surely we can't just spend as much money as we want and not worry about it. Otherwise, why have taxes at all?
Right.
You know.
I think everybody agrees that there is that point. Everybody disagrees about where that point might be. You compare Social Security in your book, and in the course of this policy discussion, you pause to compare Social Security and life itself to a tontine, which is the thing in the Robert Louis Stevenson novel and very funny movie, The Wrong Box. If you've seen that, you can explain what a tontine is.
A tontine is a form of investment where everyone puts, I mean, there are various forms of it, but the classic is everyone puts in the same amount of money, and then it sits there collecting interest until the last person in the tontine dies, and then he gets all of it, or she. It's a very strange and now illegal form of investment.
It is illegal. I didn't know it was illegal.
I am not sure. I may have made that up.
Oh, okay.
Social Security is like a tontine when mm-hmm. you think about it, because the older you get, every year you pay into Social Security, and then depending on how long you live, you get back various amounts that could be hugely varying, and African Americans don't live as long as other Americans, and so they pay a much higher portion of their income, and they get back a much smaller proportion of their income. There was a good column about this last week by Eduardo Porter in the New York Times,
mm-hmm.
but it was in my book first.
And how is life like a tontine?
Did I say that?
You did, yes.
Yeah.
You described it as, you know, part of a yuppie competition.
Yeah. Well, I mean, people who live longer get to live longer,
mm-hmm.
which is a benefit.
Mm-hmm.
And yet they live longer.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, that it's...
You have, I won't spoil it, but you have an anecdote on this point about Robert McNamara that almost made me fall over laughing so hard. But I don't want to spoil it by telling the audience. You'll have to buy the book to find out what Mike said about meeting Robert McNamara on a plane. Did you give thought to any alternative or additional gifts that baby boomers might bequeath the next generation, to cite a few bleeding heart possibilities, an end to climate change, socialized medicine, my favorite, more broadly shared wage hikes in line with productivity increases?
I'm for all of those.
So all of those would be good things to do for the next generation.
Well, you'd want some, I mean, the reason I put this long chapter certainly different from the rest of the book in, is because I think you need a large gesture, mm-hmm. you know, and so that really reduces the inventory of what you would pick.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And certainly if you want to do things like socialized medicine, solvency is kind of important if you're going to be expanding the government's responsibilities.
Well, I'm not for that.
We're just going to have to disagree about that. Yeah. One of the really loveliest passages in your book is your description of an encounter you have in a swimming pool with a 90-year-old man. And I actually don't have a question about it. I just think it's a great passage, and I was wondering if you could read it for us.
Sure.
It's pages...
And then we ought to let people ask questions.
Mm-hmm. Pages 15 to 17. Yeah, and then we'll open it up to questions.
Yeah. An encounter in the pool. At first, I thought I was alone in the pool. It was a sparkling blue gem of a pool, implausibly planted in the skyscraper canyon of downtown Los Angeles, as if David Hockney, heading toward Beverly Hills, had taken the wrong exit on the I-10 freeway. This fine pool was the consolation and only charm of the Soviet-style apartment complex where I lived so that I could walk to work at the Los Angeles Times. I never sleep anymore, an almost universal boomer complaint. So it was early, not even 6 a.m. I had finished my laps and was enjoying the emptiness of the pool, the faint sounds of downtown gearing up for the day, and the drama of the looming office towers. As we learned on September 11th, they really can fall down on top of you. But they wouldn't on that day. I felt healthy and smug. Then, what I had thought was a ripple in the water turned out to be, no, not a shark with John Williams music hectoring from a boombox in its stomach. It was a tiny old man in a tiny black bathing suit. He was slowly, slowly completing a lap in the next lane. When finally he reached the side where I was resting and watching, he came up for air. He saw me, beamed, and said, "I'm 90 years old." It was clearly a boast, not a lament. So I followed his script and said, "Well, isn't that marvelous? And you certainly don't look it," and on in that vein. He beamed some more. I beamed, and briefly we both were happy, two nearly naked strangers sharing the first little dishonesties and self-deceptions of a beautiful day in Southern California. Perhaps sensing correctly some condescension in my praise, the old man then stuck out his chest and declared, "I used to be a judge." And I started to resent this intruder in my morning and my pool. Did I now have to tell him how marvelous it was that he used to be a judge? What was so marvelous about it? What was his point? But even as he said this about having been a judge, a panicky realization of its absurd irrelevance seemed to pass across his face, and then a realization of its pathos. When he was a judge, if indeed he had been a judge. He had not felt the need to accost strangers and tell them that he was a judge. And then he seemed to realize that he had overplayed his hand. He had left this stranger in the pool, thinking the very thought he had wanted to dispel. The old fool is past it. And finally, I imagined, came sadness. He had bungled the simple social interchange. So it must be true, he was past it.
It's a wonderful. Now I guess we're ready to open it up to questions. If you could step up to the, we have mics on both sides.
Hi, Mike. How are you doing?
Hi. Say hi to Tim.
Hey, Tim. I know Mike really. I just want to say. I was born in 1965. So I'm kind of in that. I know. I'm sorry, guys, but I just want to say you were really influential on me in my 20s especially when I was watching Crossfire and eating dinner and trying to understand the world when I was 22, 23 years old. It was a great program.
Not good for your digestion.
It wasn't. And my dad just passed away, but he had Alzheimer's. I think it might have actually been even back then that he was losing it because he was turning more into Fox News. I've noticed more people seem. I don't know. That's maybe another book, but I've seemed to see that. But so really, two questions. One is, Crossfire was a great thing. Do you think we could even have a discussion like that on any news? I think it come up again. Later,
they tried it again last year, and it didn't work.
Yeah, I mean, is there any? What are your thoughts on why it doesn't work anymore?
Well, first, I want to tell a story. It's about I have a friend who passed away this past year. He was mentally retarded. I know you're not. Whatever the phrase is, and he said to me once, he loved Crossfire, and he said to me once. Mike, is that guy Buchanan your boss? And I, he could see because the real issues were sort of swept aside. He saw the psychological dynamics very accurately.
Yeah.
And the second question was about could we have Crossfire today? I don't think many people want it.
Yeah,
But I think I would be happy to defend Crossfire. I thought, there was you covered a lot of ground, and you didn't let them get away with it.
Right.
Tim Russert, may he rest in peace, was known for his tough questions. I think ours were tougher.
I agree. Just actually, the other question was, I'll sit down, is so you mentioned in your book about the writing process. Well, you talk a little bit about, I don't think I'm any worse off in being able to write good articles. And I say you have your marbles and it was a great read. But could you just tell us a little bit about it was really great to read. I'm wondering how that process continues. What do you do to, because you webbed it all together so well. I'm just wondering what your process is like.
Well, I think you saw tonight. What happens? You sort of you lose your place in the book. I don't think any substantive loss of cognition has happened. But how would I know? that's one of the things I write about in the book. It's like having trying to fix a hammer with a hammer you're trying to fix. And
but do you have a, like during the day, do you go back to the same theme and try to weave it all together? Or does it come in doses? Or how
I think what's changed is the speed. And also this tip of the tongue thing.
Yeah.
I have to write things down. I've always had to do that. You know, if you get an idea for a column or something, there aren't enough ideas just to toss them away. So I write, and but it's gotten a little worse.
For a lot of people, if they have a serious disease, an illness, or if they're getting old, hanging in the air is the word death. My impression is that you do not, you don't seem concerned about that, or at least focused on it. Do you, you want to say anything about death?
Well, it is the other option. part of denial is not thinking about it. So I guess whether I think about it more or less than the average person, I don't know. Oh, that shut them up.
Well, as long as we're on that gloomy subject, I remember very vividly when I first learned that everybody dies. It was actually before I found out how babies were born. Yeah. And I think. And I remember it quite vividly. Do you remember that moment?
No. My dad was a doctor. So and he was a surgeon. So and those were days when I think surgeons lost more patients than they lose now.
Uh-huh.
That may have had something to do with it, I don't know. But
Mm-hmm. Hi. I'm wondering, I've just turned that 65 also, and I'm kind of thinking ahead, and I guess you're in, I haven't read your book, but you're part of this thing about the policy prescriptions. I'm actually feeling a little guilty in a way that I'm taking advantage of these, you know, senior discounts when I can really afford it. You know, I go to IHOP and I get the, you know, the 2-for-1 and all that. You know, and there's a sort of an instinct in me to take advantage of it. But I also can realize that, you know, there are a lot of kids coming out of school, you know, working minimum wage if they can get a job. And that sort of, it's not exactly an inequality thing, but we're, as a generation, pretty well off, at least in Washington, maybe, or some of us, you know. And I'm still dealing with how to reconcile that, and also thinking down the line about you mentioned about Social Security, Medicare, you know, the last couple years of life of, say, somebody in their 90s, you know, the $1 million a year possibly that it could cost, you know, for this really intensive care type stuff, life, you know, life-saving, life-ending things. I guess I'm wondering at what point the country can pay for that, and who's going to pay for it now, too. It's not about Obamacare or anything like that. It's really the sort of big picture, and maybe it is this thing about us giving some of that back, you know, to help this, or maybe it won't be there for us to have it anyway. You know, the other generation just may refuse to pay for us. I don't know. I'm just wondering if your thoughts on that.
I think that's exactly what's going to happen. There is rationing of health care. And everybody knows it, but no one will admit it. And as a result, when you have situations like that, it's being done very badly, and it is unfair. I love getting a dollar off in the movies, and I don't. If you get a kick out of it, I think that's the least your country can do for you. Is let you keep on getting it.
If I could follow through on a question on that, at what point, I'm 58 and I still throw away my mailings from AARP. What is the age at which you stop throwing away your mailings from AARP?
I'm never going to reach that age. I should take that back. AARP does a lot of very good, useful things, but they are a nefarious force to prevent us from solving the entitlements problem. And it is a problem.
I wasn't making a political statement. I was saying I throw them away because I don't want to be the sort of person who gets mailings from the AARP.
Oh, well, I can't help you with that.
You yeah. Any other questions?
I have a question. I have to go watch. Mm-hmm.
That wasn't the question.
I've enjoyed your interviews and your talk so much. You seem to have a great attitude, given
comes
your
and goes.
Disease. Okay, well, that's what I was asking. I wanted to know, how do you, you know, continue with what you're doing? And what is your prescription for that? I mean, and do you, I get, I'm sure you read constantly, but do you, you must exercise, and you know, they always say you're only as old as you feel, and you know, all these cliches and so forth.
Well, I do exercise, certainly far more than before I was diagnosed. And it's the one thing I would recommend to anybody who finds out they're gonna, they have something like this, is exercise. And my wife is nodding yes, 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 because, well, because it's true. And what was the other point I wanted to make?
Attitude.
Oh, yeah, there was an interesting article in Time, I think, say maybe 4 or 5 years ago, which said that everybody is as sort of has a certain level of happiness, and you know, terrible things can happen to you, and you might get knocked off course for a while, but then you end up coming back to the to whatever your God-given or whoever-given place on the spectrum. And I thought that's oddly comforting. You know, it does, it doesn't matter how the trials of Job.
There are a couple of there are a couple of Mike Lee movies that are sort of on this theme,
yeah,
about people who are destined to be unhappy and people who seem destined to be happy. Apart from, I'm thinking of one with Jim Broadbent. I can't remember the name of it. That's quite good.
Life is Sweet.
That might be it.
That's one about a restaurant.
Anyway, it's probably for sale up there somewhere.
Question. I just want to say first, it's great to see you. I moved to Washington in the early 80s, I think, when you were probably in your prime. I remember seeing you a lot on TV. And
I don't know. My prime is yet to come.
Bravo. Good for you. It's really wonderful to see you. My question is, I haven't read the book, but there was a complimentary review in the Post Outlook section about it. It said, you say you're in denial, but the review said you've also addressed some of the treatments you've had, DBS. So you say you're in denial, but how have you, what kind of treatments have you taken to help you?
I'm not a Christian Scientist.
Right. I was just curious to address that.
Denial doesn't require quite that level, or at least I don't take it that far. That's taking it too far. And I've had the operation, deep brain stimulation, which really works. And I've tried a few things that haven't worked, including pot. I don't think what I've done is too different from what it would have been if I didn't adopt this theology of denial.
Hey, Mike.
Hey, Ben.
How you doing? You wrote a column recently, and unfortunately, I don't see your columns often enough, and I don't know if this was in
the
Post.
You don't read Vanity Fair?
I am trying to get it online. At any rate, you wrote a column about the current presidential election and the things that were good about it and heartening. And, of course, I'm having tip-of-the-tongue syndrome right now about what some of your finest points were in there. But I'd be interested, one, if you can remember what you told us, and two, if you can't, just what your thoughts are. Is this election sort of a gift to columnists like you, or what?
It is a gift to columnists, but that I had 2 points, so I have a 50-50 chance if I can get one. one was I stumbled across a quote a passage in a Saul Bellow novel, in which he says, "The people before people can be governed, they have to be entertained." And I said that's one explanation for Trump, is that he's entertaining, you know. And Hillary, I'm going to vote for her, but she's not a barrel of laughs. And then the other second point had to do with nuclear war. I covered a lot of ground in this. Nixon and Kissinger followed this theory that it's good if the other side thinks you're a bit crazy, because they don't know. They're never going to be sure. And I thought that Trump might be very good at that. Or at least as good as Putin. Mm-hmm.
Well, while we're talking about world leaders, you mentioned, I did not know before I read your book, that Adolf Hitler, we think, had Parkinson's.
Yeah, it's controversial. But there are some articles in the medical library that say it as a fact, and then others dispute it.
Has this fact made it easier for you to get inside Adolf Hitler's head?
Well, I'm not trying to get inside Adolf Hitler's head.
Is there anything, the fact that he has Parkinson's, does that tell us anything meaningful about
it? Well, the interesting question is not the effect of his having the disease, but it raises the issue of, is there a Parkinsonian type of personality? And if so, did he have that, and do I have that? And I don't think that's not one of my larger worries.
I don't think of the two of you as having much in common.
Hi,
Jeff.
I met Mike in 1973, I think, for the first time. And Tim, you've known him for a very long time. And what strikes me is that you are the person you've always been.
Oh, that's disappointing.
It's not. It's a great compliment, because you're somebody who enjoys life and are sort of amused by life, and that doesn't feel like it's changed very much. And Tim, I don't know whether how many years have you known?
You've known him longer than I have,
but
since 1980. No, you are absolutely the same person.
So it goes a little bit to
and
the
that's
book.
A good thing.
I mean, does getting older, do you feel like you're a different person as you through?
Yeah, I think to some extent. I wouldn't want to say how, but I think we all evolve. And that's not a bad thing in most cases.
I think the core
Dick Cheney being the cautionary tale.
The essence is wonderful, and that hasn't changed very much.
Oh, well, thank you, Jeff. Thank you. This is like George Bush and that in the debate.
Should we, Brad, go now to signing?
Sure. Copies of Michael's book are available at the cash register. If you just give us a minute, we're going to set up a table right here, and the signing line will form to the right of that table. Thank you again.